Okay, thank you very much for having me, and thank you very much, Barbara, for that very sweet and generous introduction. Whenever you get a nice introduction, you're always going, it's only going to be downhill from now on. And I am slightly jet-lagged, that I noticed that I'm slightly concerned that not all my sentences have proper clauses in them and finish. So if during the talk, that's an effect, I think, of jet lag rather than natural incoherence. So if during the talk you actually think there are large sections that just don't make any sense, just shout at me and I'll try and repeat them in ways that make more sense. But I hope as we get going, I'll remember what I wanted to say. So what I'm going to do today is talk with you about, to you, let's be honest, about this book that just came out earlier this year for the class, which I co-wrote with Sonia Livingston, and it's published by New York University Press. And because the project out of which the book came was funded by the MacArthur Foundation and they put some money into the publication, there's actually it is actually free. You can read it online. It's not a downloadable PDF. It's actually an online access book. And there's the URL there to have a look at it. Obviously, that will only suit those of you that like reading books online, which won't be everybody in the room, I know that. So what I want to do today is just talk with you a little bit sort of why we wrote the book, what lies behind the project, so the context and theory behind the publication. And then I'll talk a little bit and explain the methods behind the project, which is called The Class, and obviously it's significantly about social class. But it really concerns a group of kids in a class at school, and by that I mean, I don't know whether you do this in Australia, but when kids go to secondary school, they're allocated into a two group or form group. Do you have that kind of structure here? They didn't have this in America, apparently, so it became very difficult for New York University Press to agree to allow us to call the book The Class. So it's about a group of kids, basically 28 kids, who are kind of forced together in some respects for a significant part of their lives. And I'll talk to you a little bit about how we went about the research project. And then I'm going to talk about, obviously the book details a variety of different things, but I'm going to talk with you specifically about learning inside the home, and I'll show you some photographs and examples of the way that learning was kind of structured and imagined and conceptualized by the families in different homes from the kids in the class. So the contexts won't be very surprising to you. There are sort of three or four main kind of themes that lay behind the design of the research. The first of them is this kind of constant policy interest in lifelong learning and informal learning, which has become a kind of real theme. And this is a double-edged kind of consideration, it seems to me. First of all, you have a kind of greater interest in learning in different contexts and validating and valorizing forms of learning and ways of learning that aren't schooled. But at the same time, this also raises the specter of the pedagogicization of everyday life, and that is the kind of penetration of school learning into areas of work and life that aren't or haven't always been imagined as forms of kind of learning. And this therefore raises a kind of tension between a kind of an interest in investigating, exploring other kinds of learning at the same time as the research gaze ends up transfixing and surveilling these kinds of experiences as in some ways kind of educationally worthwhile. The second kind of theme we were interested in was, and this is a kind of constant interest, is the kind of investigating the claims made for the impact of digital culture and the network society on the everyday lives of young people. We were particularly interested in, we are particularly interested in the ways in which access to forms of digital technology and the kind of consumption of technology the way that technology mediates many forms of kind of inter and interpersonal kind of understandings and relationships these days. How does that actually work in practice? And that's kind of why we chose a group of kids who physically have something in common, that they are in a real world relationship as the kind of starting point for the research to investigate that. But we wanted to look at all forms of relationship that kind of a young person might kind of be involved in, and how and where they might be found and what that might mean. And then from a kind of more educational point of view, we were obviously interested in the paradox that goes on at the moment in in current education, that you have a push, particularly in the UK, and the book is an ethnography, and therefore it's quite specific, but I know this is not dissimilar in Australia, with the emphasis on standards-based education and the emphasis on kind of outcomes as a kind of definition of what counts as learning, at the same time as we are slowly beginning to kind of recognise, although not accept in political terms, what is an obvious and evident growing inequality of provision and outcomes, which is just a very contrary state of affairs. And finally, from a research point of view, as I'll explain, we were very interested in what's at stake in trying to research young people's lives in school and out of school, with their friends, with their families, to try and create a kind of 360-degree, a kind of holistic, very ambitious kind of thing there. And again, part of the aim of that was very explicitly to push back against what's common in a lot of education research, which is a kind of much more exclusive emphasis on what happens in schools in that kind of sense. So we were up for that. And as I've mentioned, the research came out of what's called the Connected Learning Research Network, which is part of the MacArthur-funded Digital Media Learning Initiative, which is an American-based foundation, the MacArthur Foundation. Some of you will have heard of the DML initiative. And we were part of a research group loosely around something called Connected Learning. And these are the kind of principles of connected learning. In the States, the research program is a little bit more normative in the sense of trying to define and describe and find forms of what they call connected learning, whereas our research was more, I don't know, naturalistic in that sense and looking at kind of everyday life of young people. But we are connected and are connected with the group of researchers and that kind of initiative. Although it should be said, the LSE, which is obviously not, you know, which is a snooty and supercilious organisation, it counted as being a sort of the exotic other from the American point of view, which is their concession to the rest of the world. But we should go for that space. I think that we use to kind of explain and explore and kind of contextualise the study is basically the theory of the sort of late modernity and the risk society. So we were interested in, this is the coming of the work of Gibbons and all the effect, I guess as you might suspect, the LSE kind of view. So we were interested in forms of detraditionalisation, so we were interested in the ways in which family and social roles are kind of being sort of unrooted in contemporary society. We're interested especially in forms of competitive individualism, and this therefore understanding how young people saw themselves as part of a collective, part of wider groupings in society, part of ethnic minorities, part of other social constituencies were kind of crucial to what we're interested in looking at. We're also interested in the kind of institutional conservatism, the way that school has become sort of hyper-school, I mean that schooling has become more intensively school-like in some respects, which is part of the kind of standards-based, outcome-driven kind of contexts that we're working in. And as I've already kind of suggested, we were very interested in networked individualism. We were particularly interested in looking at the on the hype. I mean, there's an incredible amount of writing, a public debate about the ways in which young people's lives are being transformed, all of them are being transformed by digital technology, digital culture. And one of the things we wanted to do was to try and, using sort of domestication theses, try and look at the ways in which media technology and digital culture is lived in an everyday kind of context. The DML, the MacArthur Connected Learning Research, is particularly good at looking at what they call positive deviance, looking at what we might think of as more exceptionalist kind of cases. And we were very interested to focus on kind of everyday, ordinary kind of use, which is a very difficult thing to research because if it's ordinary, why is it interesting? Or making the ordinary interesting is a real kind of paradox in that kind of sense. And so we were particularly, that was a real kind of focus of ours, and we very much wanted to look. A lot of media research, a lot of cultural studies research privileges the digital as an object of inquiry. We very much wanted to make it part of the texture of everyday life. And a final kind of caveat is we did, in the end, settle on a form of ethnography for the book. And ethnographic studies are by definition limited to their cases to an extent. So some of the kind of things that I've already mentioned in terms of claims made about the changing nature of education or the ways in which people understand learning, are nevertheless, you know, are open to other kinds of interpretation that can be contained within an ethnography. So we had three kind of key research questions. And that kind of recaps, in a sense, what I've already said. First of all, about what's distinctive about the texture of young people's lives today. In some ways, that's an historical question, but we want to kind of look at it contemporaneously. And obviously, the kind of focus on identities, the extreme interest in young people and identity formation, particularly in the ways in which they use digital media as a way of exploring, performing identity in order to look at. The second question was about what being educated means, kind of how learning is understood, and that's by both the school, the families, and the young people themselves. And also the kind of what learning is, what being educated is, can only really be understood in terms of wider social questions about the purpose and nature of education, which takes us back into the theories of the individualized risk society. And the third kind of question, in a sense, up there is a fairly classic sociological inquiry into kind of young people's lives in terms of kind of class, economic resources, and all the rest of it, those sorts of things. So what did we do with that kind of ambition? Well, as I've already suggested, we did a year-long ethnographic study of a class of 28-year-olds. They're year 9 in England. I don't know whether they'd be year 9 here.
They're
13 to 14 over the year. Okay, well, that's handy. And we wanted to try and focus on ordinary, everyday experiences of learning and friendship. So we were very interested in relationships and the kind of affective, social kind of dimension to kind of being in school, with friends, in the family. And we looked at it in terms of home, school, and social networks. And it kind of, that's what we started out looking for, but it very much worked like that. So we tried to find an ordinary school, an average school, which of course is like one of those chimeras. We found a non-selective state secondary school that's relatively proximate to where we live, because you kind of have to do that in terms of doing ethnography. It's in London, North London, so questions of ethnicity and diversity and social economic factors are slightly unrepresentative in terms of the British national picture. So it was, as it says in the third category there, there were more boys than girls, which often happens in areas where you have large immigrant populations, particularly religious communities, because those communities often prefer girls to be educated separately, which then means that the mixed schools tend to have more boys. Two of the kids in the class had special educational needs in designated official terms. One of them on the autistic spectrum, I'll talk to him about him in a minute. A third were poor, and the indicator in England is whether you qualify for free school meals. I don't know what the indicator is here, how you measure these things. Half spoke English as the first language in the class, which is pretty average for London. Half were what we call black or mixed, and the third white English, and the rest were white other. So you have a kind of white, you had there was this smallish but representative proportion of kind of European white, which is more unusual indicative of what's happening in England recently, although that's obviously going to stop after Brexit. But so it was a kind of mixed, a very kind of mixed group in social and ethnic, and any indicator you could think of, it was very kind of mixed as a kind of random sample to an extent. And as I said in the category, the second category down to the school, it was meant to be an average level of academic achievement. To be honest with you, halfway through our research, the school got inspected by Ofsted and was upgraded to outstanding, which we complained about to the head teacher. He was completely uninterested. His only comment on our research was that it would never work anyway. He wasn't going to be convinced by our complaints that he ruined our research model. And what we did was in four phases. So we, I think I'll show you, it's not easy for you. It's gone the wrong way. So there were four phases to the research, I don't know. In the first phase, we got to know the kids, and we were kind of coming, if you can say that in an ethical kind of way. So we explained to the kids to begin with we were interested in their lives and what they did with their media and things like that, but we didn't make any great demands on them or get them to sign up to the research in the first instance. So what we did was we spent time with them, the first time with them at school, getting to know them in school, and kids are used to having loads of spurious adults hanging around classrooms. So we were more of those spurious adults. And we built up a kind of relationships with the kids and began to talk with them. And we were very interested in their what they were like in school and how they behaved and the kind of experiences of learning in school. We were very clear that we weren't there to evaluate the teachers, and we weren't there in that sense to kind of research the school from that point of view. We wanted very much to try and see the children's experiences of the young people's experiences of learning, which is what we tried to do. So we spent the first term with them at school. We went to every lesson that every child went to. So we went to, they were in one class. There were eight classes in their school year, but the kids were split for classes in each half year group. So what that meant was that we couldn't just follow the one class around. We had to go to see every child in every class, if you see what I mean, and they had 8 to 10 subjects or something. So there was a lot of class observations, but that was fun. And then that allowed us to spend time getting to know them. And then we also, at school, we had access to a load of other data. So the school gave us access to the management system that they use. It's called SIMS. Do you have SIMS? It's a CAPITA. They're all globalized management systems. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So they gave us, we could log into that. And then we also went to all the kind of school events. There was a school play. There were auctions evenings where the kids, we chose this year because at the end of it, they had to choose the subjects they specialise in for GCSE, which is the first set of, you know about the English education, mm-hmm. I don't have to explain all that rubbish to you. And we also chose the year, by the way, I should say, because in theory, you're only legally, I'm not quite sure what that word means, meant to have a Facebook account when you're 13. Mm-hmm. Okay, so in theory, we chose that year, even though every child had got their Facebook account when they went to secondary school. It's like a marker of growing up, 11, 12. So that was all the school stuff, and we carried on coming back to the school over the year, although most of our intense work was in the first term. In the second term, we went home with the school, with the kids, in what I like to call a non-pervy kind of way. So by that stage, the kids kind of signed up to the research in that sense, and they were happy for us to visit them at home. So we spent a lot of time with them. We went to their homes. They did a media. A media tour of the house, so they took photographs of all the media technology in the home, and they talked to us about where and how it was used, and we recorded that. We talked to all the parents, most of whom were really keen to spend time talking with us. It's very interesting that because people don't spend time talking to parents about parenting. We looked at their kids' internet use, so we looked at their search history. Though I should say that after we went to the first kid, they posted what we did on Facebook. So I couldn't honestly say that they didn't prune their search history after we did that. We're often asked when we do this talk, both Sonia and I, whether we kind of got access to the full kind of gamut of pornography and all the rest of it that children are meant to spend the whole of their times embroiled in. And we don't really know the answer to whether how much they self-selected in that sense, to be honest. Sonia has been back and talked to a couple of the kids now, so when they're 18, and she asked them that question, and the ones that spoke to her said that we saw what they were like. Some of the kids did talk to us about what they did online. We don't really think we didn't see a great deal. So what we did see was often just very, very boring and kind of banal, rather than kind of in the kind of media sense. We became their friends on Facebook for 10 days and then defriended them. They were all happy for us to do that. And we also did quite a lot of social network analysis. So we did an online survey where the kid gave their comments about other members in the class as a kind of group. But then we also did ego networks. So we got some sense of the children's relationships with young people's relationships with extended family. And what we learned from that was for which kids school was very important in social terms, and for which kids it wasn't, and why, kind of thing. And also for which kids the class, so that random selection of people that you're allocated was important, and for which kids it was and it wasn't. And that was kind of quite revealing in that sense. And it particularly shows, of course, as you might expect, how much social capital comes into play here, so that kids from middle class homes have more extensive ego networks in some respects. Then in phase three, we kind of followed up with perhaps half the class in more kind of focused ways. So we went to, a lot of them were very interested in learning to play musical instruments, so we went to a lot of music lessons that they did privately, and that was kind of quite diverse from, the kid who had the piano teacher come to his house and do grade exams, to the Turkish boy who went to an Alevi cultural center and played the saz, which is some sort of luti instrument. We did play dates, playing computer games. We had bought some kids pizza and talked about Harry Potter. And we did, we sort of zoomed in considerable more detail on specific children over specific kind of interests, not exclusively. And then finally, we came back to them in their first term of year 10, and we got them to reflect on year 9, and we did sort of exit interviews, which had also a kind of, I don't really want to use this word, but I can't think of another one, therapeutic kind of purpose, in the sense of trying to offer some finality to the process. In terms of our general reflections about the research process, they seem to enjoy, not every child, seem to enjoy being researched. And I think the idea of having a disinterested adult who was actually interested in you was clearly a very positive experience in that sense. And they enjoyed the fact that we didn't have a stake. You know, when your parent talks to you about something or you're a teacher, they want something. And they quite enjoyed that fact, I think. We couldn't quite, that's a bit speculative, and maybe that's how I want to interpret, I don't know. So that's the kind of research process we kind of went through, and we collected an immense amount of data in terms of kind of looking at their lives with friends at home and at school. Okay, there was something else I was going to say, and it just completely slipped my mind. I'm just going to wait a second in case it comes back, but I should just move on. Okay, so what I'm going to do now is shift into a sort of case study which occupies sort of two of the chapters in the book. I'm going to talk about learning inside the home and looking at how learning, what does learning look like in non-school environments. And the home is obviously important in terms of the educational discourse that schools use to, particularly about their relationship with parents and homework itself, obviously. But there are real kind of questions about how you can imagine and identify, and particularly learning in the home, and particularly how it's kind of organized, because I think a lot of these sorts of things come down to the actual social practices and the kind of material objects that are kind of set up in the home. So what I'm going to do now is show you, I'm going to do sort of really three pairs of kids, so sort of kids, six kids, I'll talk to you about in some detail, and I'm going to show you some of the photographs from the media tour that they did as a kind of way of exemplifying this. But first to begin, I'll just point out that this is, talking about learning in the home, you don't want to overinterpret. You can see this family went and bought an expensive computer. You can see they bought a special computer table. You can also see that the chair is broken, because that's what happens in family life. So you've got to be careful about this. Secondly, you have a kind of problem about interpretation. So some of the kids' homes we went to, they were told to tidy up, obviously. I assume this child wasn't told to tidy up. You can guess which gender this child is. No, you can't? You can. So it's difficult to know how to read the kind of semiotic richness of these kinds of stages, because this is kind of, obviously, a young woman. It's so kind of full of details, all this Harry Potter stuff. You can see the pictures in there. Up there, she zoomed in on. But then you had the kind of overall kind of domestic mess. So it's kind of difficult to know how to make sense of all that. In terms of technology, what we came to the conclusion was that in some ways learning becomes equated with possession of technology. Not the use of technology, but the possession of it. So particularly how and what technology had been invested in was a way, the ways in which kind of learning is now kind of imagined, because it's kind of access issue. Mm. So here in this, this is a good example, this television, that the mother is standing in the back there, can you see her? But you can see that the television actually comes up to here on her. So this is a kind of example of the kind of prominence of technology in many people's homes. And as you probably know, there's a sort of, this is well known, there's an inverse relationship between family income and technology spend. So paradoxically, the poorer families spend, not just proportionally, but absolutely more on technology. Very few examples of what we call kind of resistance. So this young woman she was probably the most difficult person. She had the most difficult time over the year. So she was both a bully and bullied. She was always getting into impossible to resolve relationships, arguments with other young people. Mostly other kids wanted to avoid her. So it was a matter of some surprise. I mean, this was a kind of strange revelation as a bedroom in a sense. First of all, that it was so personalised that she's actually written on the wall, whereas everything else was much more consumption-driven in a sense, in terms of things that were purchased. This is much more kind of home-owned. And secondly, you can the bottom there is all her athletics medals, and her kind of time was last year in primary school, and she was absolutely suffering from a kind of, we don't have middle schools, but a classic middle school slump. So she was absolutely looking, you know, her bedroom was a shrine to when she was a very different kind of person, and when life had very different kind of things to help her. And the final kind of point I want to make is about poverty. So we really did have young people from who owned houses that were worth 2 million quid to people living in social housing. So the kind of British comprehensive school ideal kind of worked in that sense, that you have people sitting next to each other who come from very different kind of backgrounds. What does poverty mean? Well, this Kurdish family were in social housing. What it means is a television, and you can't quite see, but it's actually a VHS player. And probably some of you in the room don't even know what VHS is. So VHS was important because the Turkish-speaking videos, there's a kind of market, and these could be circulated on the, in a VHS kind of format. When we ask the mother if there are any books in the house, she goes to the kitchen and gets the bag out of the Tesco's bag, which is the supermarket, under the sink, and these are the books in the house which are kept in the bag in the kitchen, which is not how middle-class families display their books. And this is kind of a graphic, physical kind of material kind of manifestation of this. Okay, so I'm going to tell you now some stories about young people themselves. I'm going to start with Yusuf. Yusuf, I'll tell you some facts about him and I'll explain why they're pertinent. So he came from an East African family. His father had been a nurse and then, like with many refugees, has sort of had to settle for a different way of living. Or at least refugees in England. You know, we have refugees in Australia because they can't even get here. But the dad was working on the railways. Devout Muslim home, so that the computer, for example, this was very much a throwback to the early days of the computers. There was one computer in the house which was kept under the stairs. If you read the stuff about how potential technology came to the house, this is what was popular in the late 1990s, early 2000s. And the father was clear that he wanted the computer used in common use, partly as a way of encouraging the children, or of regulating the children's computer use, because he didn't want them looking at things that were un-Islamic. So obviously if it's in a public way, then the best people you can rely on to dob you in are your brothers and sisters, obviously. Yusuf, who's the young man who we studied, was a very large black boy, and I say that because the school clearly had negative expectations of him on the basis of his size and ethnicity, so that he had had a fight in the previous year, and many boys have to have fights in school for a variety of reasons. And the teachers were slightly cautious of him, which I can't disentangle from his physical presence and the kind of ways in which those kind of identities are projected onto young people for probably institutionally racist reasons. So he was also withdrawn in his English lessons, and what that meant was that his written English wasn't meant that he was withdrawn for special support rather than withdrawn for behavioural reasons. And what they didn't know about Yusuf that we found out was that he went to Quran school on 2 days a week, and on one of those days they did like Arabic, where you learn the verses of the Quran, the surah, and you recite those, and that's part of the religious requirement. But the other day they have like liberal RE lessons for discussing ethics and how to live in modern society. And then the third day of the week he went to a supplementary school to do catch-up work. So one of the curious things already about Yusuf was that he was withdrawn. The school were a bit suspicious of him because they thought he might be violent, but he's probably going to more school than they have. And didn't stop there. Because what, as I showed you the very first picture there, what that is a CD set, a drill and skill CD set, which his father had paid, I can't quite remember this fact, it's either £3,000 or £4,000, which is a lot of money, even though it's less if you're Australian now than it was when he did the research. And the younger children, Yusuf was the oldest of four kids, had brought home a flyer from the primary school, so who knows what the authorization, the validation is. Dad had bought this. They bought this drill and skill maths and English exercises. So Yusuf and his siblings had to do the drill and skill, and then they had to progress up the ladder of success. So you have a wall chart, which comes, I was going to say free, but it comes as part of the package. You have a ladder of success in English, and you have a general ladder of success. So what you do is you come and do these exercises, and you progress up the ladder of success. And the way we read, and there are other examples where the whole, so the dad described himself at one stage as like the head teacher of the family, in that sense. So school, and this kind of, I can only really describe it as sort of hyper-school schooling, which is decontextualized exercises for which there are wrong and right answers, have penetrated into the home from the school. The school, English schools at that time were obsessed with levels, the national curriculum levels and kind of testing, because it's a managerial device to show improvement, even if it's got no resemblance to any form of kind of learning. So this school perfectly, this family rather, who, as I said, had experiencing, you know, had traveled a long way in terms of the migration, who had a lot invested in Yusuf as the eldest boy who was going to go on to achieve great things, had taken kind of a school at their word, so that progress, high marks, was kind of what learning was all about, and invested a substantial amount of their family resources, and indeed the whole family life, into this kind of experience. And there are other kind of, there's a whole room upstairs that we've turned into like a school room. These are kind of images of all the kind of work. And Yusuf, they were very proud of Yusuf because he'd got his bronze award, which meant that he'd obviously finished X number of drill and skill things on the CD. And the bronze award was proudly displayed in the family silver kind of cupboard thing to exemplify. So what's kind of interesting about this story is I think it's a very painful story. I think it's obvious from, well, I hope it's obvious from my telling. But I also want to emphasize that how reasonable it seemed from Yusuf's family point of view as a way of adapting to and responding to the demands that were faced on Yusuf. It's slightly tragic because of this disjuncture between him doing all this work and them believing that he's doing something valuable in the bronze thingamajuggle, and yet he's withdrawn in English, which any teacher will tell you basically means they don't think he's going to do well enough in GCSE, which kind of means that he's not really going to progress with the same sort of ambitions that they think he's going to have. So there's a sort of tragedy in the expectations, it seems to me, built into this kind of story. But as I said, what's extraordinary is the ways in which this forms of schooling have been kind of commercialized, commodified, and consumed by this family in order, in the belief, the reasonable belief from their point of view, that it will allow him to succeed in that kind of sense. And I want to compare this a little bit with, sorry, that was just a picture of the football was on when we left to see it. Compare a little bit with shame. And shame probably was the only, was a white working class boy, sort of, and for us, he exemplified a sort of Paul Willis, you know, a lad. And he was the only one in the class, which is kind of, in that sense, a story of social change, since Willis, I mean, we were in London and Willis did his study in a northern industrial city, but it was indicative. Now, shame was interesting for a variety of reasons. And what I want to, whereas the case I want to make, I made with Yusuf, was this kind of hyper-schooling, I want to show how his family kind of tried to do the same, but didn't have anything underneath it all. So it's like a sort of simulacrum of schooling, if you like. So his room also was like many of the boys, was very compartmentalized. So he had an area for work, and there's his work table. And this was very, very typical of every, you were clearly failing as a parent if you didn't provide this kind of work. It looks like your offices, I would say. Anachronism itself is an anachronism, but soon you won't have offices because they'll shut them down, sell the land off or something anyway. But I mean, this is kind of what work is meant to be, like sitting in an office, yeah? Then Shane, imagine if we were looking at his room, on that side was the work, and then in the middle is this air hockey table, and then on the extreme, on the left, as it were, you then have the real screen, which is his Xbox. So you have this kind of compartmentalization of work and play, which is kind of a basic structure of post-industrial society, even though it's completely irrelevant, to kind of, has no meaning in kind of people's life. The thing is that Shane didn't do anything on the computer at all, because his parents had invested in it because they thought that's what they ought to do. We looked at his search history, it was all about shopping. He wasn't even very interested in Facebook because he actually much preferred being out and hanging out with his mates. So there was nothing that the parents did, whereas Yusuf's parents bought into the idea of kind of schooling in this particular kind of grammar. Shane's mum did the same, but there was nothing kind of there, if you saw it. It was like as I say, some acronym. The Xbox screen was vital. The boys, some of the girls, mainly the boys, either had Xboxes or PlayStations, and this was important because when you play a computer game on one of those, if you're networked, you can't play with the opposing platform. So if your friends have got Xbox, you've kind of got to buy an Xbox, if your friends have got PlayStation. So there was almost a social class distinction between the kid, the middle class boys, almost, it didn't, and it's too small a sample. The middle class boys who had like PlayStations and played in, they didn't, boys had a tough time, had a tough time of it. And the families, but they were a bit like, treated a bit like dogs, really, boys, because they're, you know, they're nice, you know what I mean, they're kind of affectionate, but they are a bit messy, and they leave mud on the floor, and they will knock things over because they're a bit kind of clumsy. So the boys weren't really encouraged to go around and go to each other's homes, because the other mums didn't really want lots of boys in their homes in that way. Shane was unusual, for a variety of reasons, in the freedom he had to go outside and cycle around. The other boys were much more kind of controlled and they're kind of regulated, and the girls were very severely regulated in terms of their free movement through space. So Xbox was crucial because it allowed what happened is the boys would arrange to play games with each other. Some of the boys weren't that interested in the game playing. I'll talk a bit in a minute about a more intensive kind of game player. But you had to play good enough to play the games to join with your friends. So they would put Skype on their headsets, play the game, and kind of hang out with each other. So because they weren't really welcome, particularly in other families' kind of home. But the point I really want to make with Shane, comparing Shane and Yusuf, is this: how one family, they both appear to buy into the kind of schooling, but what that means is they want to sort of empty, and one is hyper school. So a little example now from more middle class homes. Talking a little bit about Dominic and Sarah. I'm not just keeping an eye on time. I won't talk that much about Sarah because I haven't got that much to say about her in this sequence as well. But These are just her Facebook page. She made Play-Doh kids, as typical with a lot of the middle class kids, following a sort of Annette Leroux kind of interpretation of what Sarah did with her Play-Doh is she made galleries to demonstrate her, she curated, that's the trendy word, isn't it? She curated her Facebook page to show her artistic qualities in her Facebook page. I'm going to talk mainly about Dominic, I think. So these are rooms from Dominic's family, possibly one of them came from one of the richer families. So this is Dominic's bedroom and also one of his brother's bedrooms. There are three of them in the family, three boys. Tell me what's odd about, this is what passes for interactive teaching, as you probably know from your teaching and learning day. So what do you notice about that picture? What's missing? Just to help with the IRE here. There's the right answer, by the way. Don't try and be clever.
Well, it could be an IKEA catalogue.
Okay, that is absolutely true. That isn't the right answer, I'm terribly sorry to say. There's no screen, yeah, okay. It could be an IKEA catalogue, it probably is an IKEA catalogue. Why is there no screen? Because Dominic's family had access to different discourses about what constituted learning. They wanted to control screen use of the boys. Why did the mother particularly want to do this, given that dad worked in actually corporate IT? Why did they want to do this? For a variety of absolutely sort of ideologically driven reasons. Not because they were particularly scared or anxious about screen consumption, because there were two computers in the house, and there were, excluding dad's computer, for mum's. So mum and the three boys shared two computers. Why? Two reasons. One is they were very clear she wanted to teach them to share. So from a richer family, they absolutely wanted to enforce a form of parenting that encouraged other kinds of social values. Secondly, there was an element of regulation going on. As I've already said before, you can't really do things that your mother might not want you to do, because you can absolutely be certain your brother will tell you. At the wrong moment on that kind of score. So there was, it performed both kind of functions, and they were very clear about this. But they were also clear, unlike Yusuf and Shane, who, in order to provide learning for the families, did what they thought the school wanted, even though I kind of suggested they might not have got that absolutely right. This family had other access to other values about what learning was. So besides sharing and they were much more keen to provide a mixed economy of leisure activities. So Dominic was by far the most active boy in terms of sports participation, which you might not expect. Well, I don't know what your assumptions are. So he went both to cricket, which actually in England is pretty rare, and soccer practice. And why did he do that? Partly he obviously enjoyed it, and he was obviously good enough to enjoy, but significantly because the parents had a view of a kind of rounded character development, things that you got from playing sports, that they were very kind of explicit at. You could play sports at school, and he was in the soccer club at school, but that wasn't particularly the kind of issue here. It was about providing that outside of the school. So this family had access to a whole other discourse of what learning is meant to be about. It's about developing yourself, it's about learning to share, so there's a moral and social kind of qualities that we haven't seen so far. The family was well off enough, they had a special playroom. He was in the PlayStation fraternity, for what it's worth. But this is all kind of nicely set up, and these are just to exemplify how well off, just in kind of material object terms, he was. Okay, I'm comparing obviously Dominic's family's access to different discourses of learning and what that kind of means in textual, the sort of texture of day to day kind of experience. So I'll now just finish off with, because then we can have a bit of time to chat, a couple of stories about Adam and Giselle. This is the bookshelves in Adam's family to compare with a kind of the Tesco's bag I showed you, and this is the Minecraft. Giselle was a kind of key Minecraft player. And this story is very much about their uses of game playing and how game playing was both played out in both of these families. So in Giselle's family, she came from an arty family that we ended up describing as bohemian. I don't know if that's the right term, but we couldn't find anything better. So you can see that she was interested in, she had a younger brother, she interested in art, but they made Minecraft figures. So it became an object for kind of family making. And this was a family that, both the families were artists and therefore not terribly well off in material terms, but had high cultural capital. So when they went away on holiday, for example, they often took sketchbooks, which sounds a bit pretentious perhaps, but this is, that's what you do if you're an artist, if you sort of mean. So I wouldn't want to suggest it's a concerted cultivation. It was just because that's what the family did in that sense. And the father was talked to us particularly about why he was very happy for Giselle to play online. And he had, whereas I've suggested before that Dominic's family had access to sort of a view of moral learning in a way, he was interested in sort of 21st century learning. So he said quite explicitly that negotiating online, all the stuff, the sort of Jim G stuff about learning to play video games, these were all forms of learning that he wanted his daughter and his son, but the son was younger, to have access to as part of what being educated was. So a cousin in this family had a Minecraft server, she was an administrator, she had administrative privileges, she had to regulate some other people's use, and he was very positive, the family was very positive about this as an educationally worthwhile experience. Okay, so these are kind of just some pictures of, they're not terribly good, they're very meaningful, pictures of Giselle's kind of family that's kind of showing the kind of arty family. This is her bedroom, a bit more arty. So there's obviously more depth to the story, but what's interesting here is that you have a middle class family where the kind of practices, and I think we'd say the same about the art use, that they weren't, they had their own kind of understandings of what learning art would be about and how to kind of promulgate them, which were, if not in opposition to the school, I mean, we were quite surprised in general by how little opposition there was to the school. Part of the kind of general tenor of the whole study is a story of extraordinary kind of social compliance and kind of buy-in, even though it clearly wasn't working in everybody's interests. But Giselle's family did have access to other values, other kind of theories of what learning should be about and education, and they were therefore happy to provide those in the home. The final story I'll leave you is Adam, and this is a kind of more fraught story about gaming and the values attributed to kind of gaming and therefore by extension the technology in general. So like Shane, Adam started the year, and this is a bit of a sort of Ericksonian dialogue, you'll see, he started the year differentiating between work and play. So play's his Xbox, work is his solitary laptop on a rather shishi IKEA world. Yeah, you can see this kind of set out like that. Now, Adam's family, this might sound crazy, but his father was German. And I need to say that for a variety of reasons. He liked playing computer games. He was probably, at the beginning of the year, the only kid I would really characterize as a serious gamer. So he bought magazines, he read a lot of stuff online. He was really he played a different range of games. The other kids were extraordinarily conservative in their use of games. They all played FIFA, whatever year it was, Call of Duty. He was much more interested in exploring a real world, I've forgotten the word now, where you just exploring the world in a computer game. So he had other access to other ways of enjoying computer games. He played with friends outside the school. He was a very disengaged boy in school, came from a middle class family, but he was one of those boys that found it very difficult to wake up in the morning, and he wasn't jet-lagged. So he was very dopey, basically, in class, and he was very disengaged, he was obviously unhappy, but he really liked playing games. But, as I said, his father was German, and there was a whole discourse in the family about how his father in particular was very upset with war games because of being a war baby. So the family didn't like him playing computer games. He was really liked playing computer games. He didn't like school very much. He was pretty disengaged. He liked being with his friends. What do you do? Right. So the mother talked to us particularly, his mother talked to us particularly about how she recognised that playing games was a form of engagement, that it offered him forms of learning, at, like I was saying with Giselle's family. So she had access, I don't think she read Jim G's work, but she had access to those discourses about kind of 21st century learning. But they were compromised because it involved playing games that they didn't like in the family, and it became a kind of moral, ethical question. So that completely kind of left him in a difficult place. So what happened as the year progressed? It was also interesting that he did his German exam, GCSE, so his the exam you can do at 16, early. So he liked being able to speak German, and he gave him access to doing this GCSE early, which gave him academic success. But the Germanness otherwise was a kind of source of kind of great social difficulty. What was interesting over the year was that by the time we came to the end of the study, this is why it says an Ericksonian dialogue, he'd reconciled. So you can see here all the equipment is now in one place, because obviously you can use the same screen to, you know, there's a lot of funny things about the work-play kind of binary in that kind of sense. And he'd become less interested in gaming. So he kind of had stopped playing computer games, but he was much more motivated. The German had become a route to school success rather than a source of anti-schooling, if you see what I mean. Anti-learning and the kind of games world. So he'd become, the family had kind of worked through this tension in that kind of way over the year in that way. So the point I want to make really with both Giselle and Adam is how much those families' high cultural capital means that other theories of learning, which perhaps the theories of learning that we as professional educators, I think that's what we are, might espouse, might be interested in, might care about, that their families negotiated the school learning within these other kind of spaces and found a way to give their kids access to and kind of support for these other kind of theories of learning without criticizing or conflicting with the school, even though we know there are direct conflicts and kind of contradictions going on in that kind of way. And that is obviously to show the way, and this obviously shows in some ways what we've always known in education, it's a kind of repeat the story, about how forms of cultural capital and class kind of completely mediate and change the meaning of what it is to be educated in that way. So that's the kind of case study I want to talk with. I'm going to stop talking formally to you, as it were, and we can have a bit more discussion. The conclusion for the whole book, which obviously espouses other chapters around civility, the kind of ways in which the school tried to construct community with these extraordinarily socially diverse kids. There's long sections about the way the learning is kind of conceptualized in the school as simply through a progression of levels and so on. But I just wanted to share that example with you, partly because it's about a subject very close to my heart, but partly also because it's visual, and if you're doing a talk, it's good to have photographs. Some of the other stuff isn't quite as good to show. But the book itself, we ended up riffing on those three words, basically: connected, competitive, or conservative, in that sense. So we were quite struck by actually how disconnected everybody was. So you have the facility for extraordinary interconnectedness across these different social domains. We were very struck how each sphere of influence, so family, friends, and school, actually, for all the talk of breaking boundaries down and crossing over, were actually spending far more energy on maintaining boundaries and making disconnections. And we were very struck, I suppose, by the end of the book, about the positive power of disconnections. And rather than necessarily seeing this in terms of failures of to connect, that because there is a sort of assumed ideology in our times that connecting is a good thing, maybe disconnecting is also a good thing. We were very struck by these kind of boundary maintenance. So the school, why the school disliked Facebook so much, and I can talk a bit more about that if you want me to. And these boundaries were strongly patrolled for privacy reasons, because young people have extraordinary lack of control over their lives. I mean, it was quite striking to us, and spending the whole year with them, and their kind of control. And so the kind of ability to kind of maintain more private spaces was very, very important. As I said, we were many of the kind of presumed kind of connections were pathetic and didn't work. So the attempt to do blogs in maths and things like that, which were kind of destined to a shelf life as soon as they left the kind of classroom. The ways in which the VLE just never worked, I don't know, and things like that. It was kind of extraordinary. And I suppose the overall kind of story is in some way what we call sort of small victories. That, I mean, I described with Yusuf the kind of, what I felt was a, clearly sort of, we both felt was a kind of unfolding tragedy of miscommunication. And I think over the year we were really kind of struck by the small losses and gains in which, by which kind of families not knowing about what happened at school, the school not knowing what happens in families, and how this is kind of confusion. But at the same time, that may be a reasonable kind of, well, is it a reasonable kind of cost to bear, given that you don't actually want everybody knowing your business either side of kind of any of those boundaries? And it was kind of fraught kind of experience in some ways, spending the time over the year. I've been talking for 15 minutes now, so I shall stop talking at you and let's have some questions. And I hope that all made sense with the jet lag. Mm-hmm. But thank you.
Comments,
things you want to know more about?
I had a question. You mentioned very early on about the pedagogicization of life, and I work in health sciences, and there's a healthicization of life. And I was just wondering, in your analysis, you talked about boundary making and crossing. Was there any times where you felt like you weren't looking at learning, but at the production of, say, something more amorphous in health, like well-being or mental health, given the age of your community and things like screen time, social contact, and things like that?
I challenge screen time as a kind of health construct. I don't think that's really how it works. But your more general point about, I think we were very interested, you used the term well-being, which I don't know whether we do. We were very interested in non-schooled forms of learning, and indeed the whole book was about that. So it was about, but we were kind of, so we were interested in, we weren't really there to make judgments about better or worse ways to achieve those kind of outcomes, because in some sense that's something you said absolutely above. But so the story about the girl who was always in trouble and had difficult relationships, or the boy Dominic, whose parents wanted him to play sports because they thought it was good for him, he was the most, perhaps for what it's worth, very popular. Whether he was popular because he played sports or because the sports play made him popular, you'll never know, kind of thing. So there were other aspects to their happiness, their contentment, their confidence. I guess would have been perhaps perhaps a more obvious kind of focus, spending time with 13, 14 year olds. And their independence are all kind of non-schooled outcomes, although OECD are now interested in analysis. I think they are all domains where some learning is involved. So you learn to become all those things. So what we've tried to do with some of the study is uncover the processes by which that happens. It's not, because it's an ethnography and therefore it's kind of realist in that sense, it doesn't you know, it's not an experiment to determine better or worse ways of doing that, but the point of this sort of study is to raise those questions. I mean, and also to show how those kinds of domains exist in concert with other ones. So we obviously set out, in some respects, just to look at Facebook, if you see what I mean. But we were really interested, then Facebook very quickly became just simply a mode of looking at relationships. And we were very interested in the range of and nature of the kinds of relationships that the young people had, were exposed to, were involved with, how much they were simply dragged along to other family things, how independent, you know, those sorts of things. So it becomes, this way in becomes a stalking horse, I think, for looking at those other kind of areas. And then relationships, we were also very interested in their relationship. How did social relationships work within the classroom, within school, and even the social relationships you have with your the adults in your life and things like that. So as I say, what started out as a Facebook-y thing, I guess you're kind of talking, asking some analytic question about, you know, what are your objectives in terms of studies in that sense, and in some sense it's the kind of vocabulary you use or the kind of things you're focused on. I kind of think everything is learning, so I can't, and you certainly have to learn how to become those things, yeah. Is what I mean. So, they're not natural states of being.
Absolutely. And I guess that was my question, was when parents are saying things like, here's the way we organise the room, or here's the way, whether they were coming from a kind of a discourse informed by school and education, or coming from a discourse...
I think we saw, like with Shane, I think is a good example, where they thought they were trying very hard to do what they thought was right, but didn't know what to do, kind of thing. Or Yusuf, who'd taken on board something, a kind of extreme kind of... overcompensation in a kind of way, and then without knowing what's at stake, you run the risk of being gulled, you know, gulled basically.
When you started this research, did you always intend to mainly focus on what was happening outside of school, or did that kind of emerge as you?
No, I've only talked about that today, really. I mean, the first half of the book is about what happens in school in that sense. We tried to, I mean, a young person's life is mainly spent at school, except when they're not at school, because I mean, we just talked about them. I mean, and in some ways, what this was talking about their life outside school, but all I've done is talk about learning, and that's partly because I'm interested in it, but also partly because that's where a child's work is. Right? That's because I think this emphasis on, I don't know the pedagogization of their life is a useful term or not, but this kind of remorseless spread of it's a moral obligation in kind of individual society, and it's certainly extraordinary kind of success, you know, in a Bernsteinian world, it is a sort of totally pedagogized society kind of scenario. So we talked a lot about actual school and schooling in the book, so there's a lot of studies about the way learning is framed in the school, which is absolutely, at that time, was very much in terms of these national curriculum levels.
Did you see that sort of pedagogization of learning in everyday life? Did you see that sort of coming into the school and how that was kind of moving around in the school, that kind of way of...
The school, it's a one-way relationship, the school family. The school weren't terribly interested and didn't think it's their business, or they were interested at individual teacher level, but not formally set up to kind of, the families were there to comply with what they wanted to do. The discourse in the school was extraordinarily about this levels business, which was a particular kind of mode where every subject is divided into 10 curriculum levels. So when we went to parents' evening, when you get a report in an English school, you don't get told anything about, you're told how hard, you know, it's a moral, whether you work hard or you don't. But then you're given a level, and then you're given a normal, an expected level for your child to receive, and then you're given a level dependent on the added value of the school. And then you're given a kind of an average level. So you're a parent, you went to school, and you're just given like four, you're just told maths, English, 6B, 6A, 6C or something, right? Everything is reduced to a numerical metric. So all you really want to care about is whether you can go from, bizarrely, 6C was better than 6A. This confused Sonia particularly, thought very strongly that A should be better than C. So when you get to 6C, you go to 7A. And so all you want to do is to know how can I get up the ladder of success in that kind of way. And that was very apparent in the lessons, as opposed to a discussion about why history, so that in the book there's kind of a nice study, for example, looking at Black History Month and the way in which the black students in the book, their experiences absolutely aren't recognised, and indeed it's far too difficult for the school to kind of accommodate social difference in its kind of version of a kind of civil society that it constructs.
What really strikes me with this study in junior secondary is how consistent the findings are with decades of studies in the early years. Researchers have been going out into families and homes and charting a lot of the ways in which parents, use their cultural capital and their social capital and their economic capital. But as a person who's been trotting along to conferences for now decades and presenting this kind of stuff, there's usually very few education people in the room to listen to it. So I guess, how do you find yourself getting on when you engage with school leaders, with policymakers, with people within schools to say, hey, I've been hanging around year 9 people's homes and taking photographs of their bedrooms and things like this. Wouldn't you like to know what parents are doing? Like, how do you get on? Because I hope you get on better than what I've been getting on.
That's a great question. We have done quite a lot of talks to teachers, and at least teachers are, and we are very interested in finding ways to turn this kind of way of thinking about people's learning into teacher training. And the teachers have been very receptive, very interested, and just bewailed the exclusion of this way of looking at things in their everyday life and the difficulty. I mean, whether it makes any one teacher go away and just ask their children, their students a few more different questions would almost be enough as a starting point. It's very difficult to kind of get into teacher training curricula, this kind of thing. We haven't had, the reviews we've had in Education Press kind of say it's not very useful for improving schools. And on the sort of...
I think it reminds me of some work that Warrington and Young were doing in the UK around the gender issues. Some of us, Phil and Barb, have been involved in looking at boys in school and looking at what's going on at homes and things. And there was a study where at the school the teachers were all talking about what a shame it is that boys aren't really very interested in reading and the lack of male role models, etc., etc. And that school decided to actually survey parents and children and boys about what's happening at home. And they found out that, lo and behold, boys have got fine reading at home and their dads read as well, and they didn't really have a problem with it. So it comes back to the school. I think it's very useful for teachers to get involved in doing that kind of inquiry and getting their students to be involved, because then we do have to have another think about what is it that we are blaming homes for.
And when we tried to write the book so that teachers would read it.
Mm.
But I don't know about boys, but teachers certainly don't read. So, I mean, and it's probably too long, for teachers. And then there's that wretched chapter about postmodern, theory and late modernity, which you're going to have to do in an academic book. So it's kind of, we ethnography, we thought, is a good way of telling stories, of convincing people through that power of anecdote in that kind of sense. And it is written for an academic book pretty excessively if you're prepared to sit and read a book. What do you do as a scholar? What do you do as an academic? How do you think you make a difference? I mean, the answer is don't get your hopes up. I mean, doing these kind of talks with teachers, I think is a positive experience, and I guess the point of the book is to kind of change people's minds, to help them think a little bit. I mean, we haven't been invited to programmatize any of this. I'd be very interested in that kind of challenge. If getting things out there, yeah, I think probably the most successful interventions in education research recently were those television series. Did you see those Educating Essex? And and partly we were inspired by that kind of the effect of that documentary, which I think is a kind of way forward. And it'd be great to be able to make. I'd be very interested in making. You can't really make this sort of thing in a film because it would be too complicated. Going to the home stuff. I mean, how do you get people to think differently about education? It's bad enough getting them to think differently about saving the planet, or to think about the other decisions that the people have been involved in recently. And I can't stress enough how kind of reason that people's, clearly the story I'm told today is very different from the story in the first bit of work I did in 1994, The Cultural Studies Goes to School, which is much more a story about kind of opposition and resistance in some ways. It's not about that. It's about forms of conservatism. And how do you get, and it's not just the people, I mean, how do you get teachers to think differently about what what teaching should be about? I mean, I don't know, I've got no idea. I mean, I try, you sort of mean, you try, we all try. And there are perfectly good reasons why people aren't very interested in this kind of message. I mean, they don't care. So schooling performs other social functions, as we know. But most of the teachers that you talk to are, of course, terribly interested in thinking about their kids' lives in this kind of way, but aren't encouraged to. I feel a bit of this is the question that counts, and I always feel a bit inadequate. I feel particularly inadequate answering it.
Julian, just perhaps move it over to, for academics or theories, and you kind of referenced Willis, and his takeaway was kind of learning to labour. And I think, like that study that Sue mentioned, Young and Warrington really picked up on and talked about laddish culture, so put gender and class together as a problem. And I think Willis was very influential in that way of thinking about education. What do you have to say to people who use Willis or who continue to put gender and class at the top and everything else kind of comes after that? Do you think you have something to say to those ideas?
If I'm absolutely honest, I'm not terribly sure how original our contribution might be on that kind of stake. I think, in that sense, we tell a story about Bourdieu more than fundamentally, and we were very struck by